Okay, begin, please.
So, good evening, everyone. Welcome to the Satyagraha Talk series, Voices from Punjab and Haryana in the context of farmers' movement. As yesterday's discussion centered around discussing political parties, the role of opposition, and general atmosphere that is prevailing in the country right now as far as the responses and interactions that are happening in the farmers' movement is concerned. I think what is important in this movement is the massive participation that is coming in from all corners, that is not only limited to Punjab and Haryana or the northern states in general, but also to other states. So there were different aspects that were discussed, whether it was environmental demands, women participation, tracking down the development of the movement ahead of the January 26th Republic Day trolley march that is going to be displayed as a source of as a sign of resilience and strength of the movement. There are a lot of key angles and dimensions of this movement that need to be discussed, and there has to be a critical dialogue around it. So we can have the opening comments from Sandeep ji. Meanwhile, the speaker joins in.
Okay. So thank you, Simran. And the good news is that the government has at least shown a sign of relenting, and it has said that it is willing to put on hold the laws for 1.5 years. The Supreme Court had only stayed it for 2 months and wanted the 4-member committee to come up with a report within 2 months, and until then the laws were stayed. But it is good that following a general direction given by Supreme Court, the government has decided to put the laws on hold for 1.5 years, and this will give ample time to both sides to flesh out the details of their arguments, and the government will also get a time to rethink, although there are two opinions about this, I mean, which I am hearing from people. One opinion is that this is a kind of face saving, because the government would not have completely withdrawn the acts, because then that would have opened a Pandora's box. Then, the Muslim community would have demanded the repeal of Citizenship Amendment Act and the revocation of National Register of Citizens. The Kashmiris would have asked for revocation of the decision to abrogate Articles 370 and 35A. And the environmentalists would have asked the government to take back all the amendments that they have made. Environment impact assessment regime. The labor organizations, trade unions would have put pressure on the government to withdraw the changes made in the labor laws. Although all these need to be done. I mean, all these changes which the Modi government has brought should be taken back, because a number of them are actually anti-people. But that is government's problem. It doesn't want to open that Pandora's box. And therefore, it has put a hold only for 1.5 years, and hopefully, this stay will be there, for a longer time. Just like even though the government has not taken back the CAA and NRC, but because of coronavirus, the movement going on, the sit-ins that were going on throughout the country had to be wound up because of the threat of coronavirus. But then the government, which was threatening to implement CAA and NRC all over the country, Amit Shah had declared it in the Assam elections, that it will be implemented all throughout the country. So that did not happen. And I think the government had got a message from the strong protest during the last winter against the CA and NRC that the people, especially the Muslim community, would not take it lying down, and they would resist it to their last breath. And the government did a wise thing of not implementing it. So similarly, I think the farm laws, the implementation may be put on hold for a longer period, even though it has been declared only for a year and a half. But then the other opinion is that the government wants to buy time. It wants to give time to Adanis and Ambanis to build their godowns and put into place a regime whereby the implementation of these laws would become easier for the government. And the government will definitely try to do it before the next Lok Sabha elections. And would like to take the credit for it in the next Lok Sabha elections, and that is why they have given a period which ends much before the next Lok Sabha elections. So Lok Sabha elections are in 2024, and 1.5 years from now will be mid of 2023. So just about 7, 8, 9 months before the polls, the government may try to implement it to appease its sponsors, because these laws directly benefit the corporate sector, and everybody knows that Adani and Ambani are the biggest sponsors of this ruling party. And for them, there has been a change in the laws relating to electoral funding. Now you can donate through electoral bonds without having to declare, the amount that a particular company is donating, and without mentioning the party to which you are donating. So, a regime has been set up where, in an opaque manner, Ambani and Adani can donate unlimited amount of money to Bharatiya Janata Party, which it can use to be in power. And therefore, it has to make it easier for Adani and Ambani to make money. Because unless they make money, how will they give it to the BJP? It is so strange that whereas all the businesses suffered a setback during the coronavirus lockdown period, Ambani made a huge profit. So even in crisis, the government makes it easy for them to make profit. It is such an unfortunate thing for a country where a vast majority of its poor had to suffer because the salaried class, the business class, could sustain on its savings and on their salaries, which were not stopped. But the daily wage earner suffered a setback because they could not survive beyond a few days, beyond a month or so, if they did not have their regular income. So in a country, where the poor suffered, vast number of poor, the biggest corporate house was making profit. Itself is insane. That is morally unjustified, that you are making profit on people's tragedy. So the equation is such that government will have to do something to please its sponsors, and therefore Rahul has asked a question whether it will not be detrimental for BJP. Rahul, ideally we would think that it would be detrimental, but we have seen that in spite of taking a number of anti-people measures like demonetization and you know, other things. The BJP was able to win elections essentially because of a propaganda, which was totally false. So by unleashing a false propaganda on people, by projecting Modi as a very strong leader and as a defender of the nation and always ready to take on any challenge from outside, his image has been projected as if he is the only one who can protect the country. Although people forget that, you know, he is essentially using a system which was set up by previous governments. I mean, he did not come and set up the army bought all the arms that the army has. Even the Rafael deal, you know, was initiated by the previous government. So this government has created an impression as if, you know, it is the savior of the nation, and this message has been conveyed to people. People are gullible. They have believed this message because that is the only message which is beamed to them. There is no alternative, and therefore they keep winning elections. So with their money power, even if they take an unpopular decision, they may be able to win the election. So in the end, it may not turn out to be detrimental for them, unless there is an equally strong campaign from the opposition parties, which projects Modi government in a bad light, like it has happened during the farmers' struggle. During the farmers' struggle, it has become very clear that the Modi government is a pro-corporate and anti-farmer, anti-people. This message has gone very clearly. So, and it has happened because of the movement. If the movement was not there, it would not have happened. Because people were just silently suffering the actions of this government. And now at least there is some awakening. But whether it will translate into votes against the BJP government remains to be seen till the next elections. Go ahead.
Sorry, I actually forgot in the start, sir. Thank you so much for the publication in Indian Express. That was a dream come true. I never anticipated that a little bit of effort in the editing would bring about such an impact. And I've been like receiving a lot of good messages. A bit negative ones too, that we exaggerated things, but I don't think so. It was an exaggeration. I think it was putting the pieces together and painting a real picture of the scenario. And thank you so much for it was an honor to be featured with you. So I think a couple of questions are there in the chat box, and I just want to say that ma'am will not be able to join because there's a network issue at her end. But the two things I wanted to discuss with her was the constitutional framework and the crumbling down of federalism in respect of these laws. She speaks in Punjabi. Fluency is in Punjabi, and in Punjabi, federalism or federal structure is known as the Sanghi Dhancha. And what we've seen primarily with all the legal developments that have been taking place, especially since 2019, whether it is amendments to the UAPA, NIA, it has to be under the central realm of control. But if you see electricity amendment laws, if you see labor laws, now farm bills, all these socio-economic laws that fell under the purview of the states, the key decision-making, the institutions that render the operation of the act, all have, it's becoming increasingly centralized. The center has amassed vast amounts of power to itself. to carry forward this. Now, this is something that has sort of created an imbalance between the powers of the states and the center. And let's not go down the GST road, because that is a separate topic about compensations and loss of financial, financial loss to the states because of GST. But just remaining centered on the constitutional framework, because federalism is a basic structure of the constitution. Any imbalance, any dent would and any tension that is there between the center and the states is something that is unhealthy, and that is, in violation of the constitutional principles. And if it is being done, and if it is being done by the rapid legal amendments to make sure that, constitution always sways in favor of the center. It does give center slightly more powers than the state, but that does not mean that the center has such huge powers that it completely cripples away the powers of the state. But if you analyze the legal amendments or the laws that have been made or amended, it just like state center is a deciding factor. Even if it's the farm bills or if the labor laws, I can go on and quote a lot, many other laws as well. But these are like central to central socioeconomic laws that affect all citizens. So this is something that I wanted to take up, and we need to examine the farm bills and how do they impact federalism. What is the role of states? What are the powers that are in that are given to the states in this? Because in the previous, the APMC Mandi structure, the states were the defining institutions, or there has been a rapid change in the way structures are controlled, in the way ownership structures are there. And I think the anticipation has to be done pragmatically about the future of these laws. So about federalism.
Yeah. So you are a student of law, and if you pick up the constitution,
mm-hmm.
there is the seventh schedule.
Yes.
The seventh schedule, and I have it in front of me. There is list one, which is union list. And if you start reading the list, you don't see agriculture anywhere.
Hmm.
I can't see agriculture anywhere.
Because it's not there.
It is not there. Yeah, it is not there. And then...
See, the constitution purely defines, the legislative domains. There's a reason why there's a classification done state-wise.
Yeah.
List-wise. That only the center can make laws on these, only the state can make laws these.
Then if you look at list two, state list, then point number 14. Point number 14 is agriculture, including agricultural education and research, protection against pests and prevention of plant diseases. So, which means that agriculture was a state subject. I mean, I inadvertently said was, because the Modi government has made it in the past. It has usurped the power of the states and made a law which was not in its jurisdiction. So I think the Supreme Court should have stayed the laws just on this one point. That you first ask all the state governments to pass this law, only then we will allow this law to be implemented. That should have been the stand of the Supreme.
The competency to enact these laws in the very first place.
Yeah. So, that is a direct attack on the federal structure, because you are doing something which is against the constitution of this country. And... you are not even consulting the state government. So, for example, if you had done something like you did for the GST, where at least now there is a GST council, which has the finance minister of all the state governments. So there is some consultative process with the state governments. But even that was, a blow to the idea of federalism, because in the name of one nation, one tax, the government, you know, fooled people, and they made such a big issue out of it. They implemented the law at midnight in the parliament, you know, as if it was similar to you know, the country gaining independence, because as you know, the transfer of power from the British to the Indian government took place at midnight in 47 on 14th August, 14th and 15th, the intervening night. So it was fooling people, because in the name of one nation, one tax, what the government did, it usurped the power of state governments also. And it said, we will collect the tax and then we will distribute it to the states. And then they were not able to collect tax to the extent that they had expected. And obviously the states did not get a share. And now they tell the states that go and borrow money. This is very strange, you know. The Mr. Prime Minister Modi is very fond of the Atmanirbhar Bharat slogan, but he doesn't want the states to remain Atmanirbhar. He wants them. He wants the state to be dependent on the center. So
precisely.
So this the laws that are made are against the constitution, and every decision of the Modi government appears to be centralizing the political power, the political decision making power. I was just passing through an area in Lucknow where digging was taking place to lay down the sanitation lines and the sewage lines, and the friend who was traveling with me said that, do you know where this money is coming from? And I had no idea. So he said this money is coming from the Clean Ganga Mission, because all the projects related to the sewage, laying down the sewage lines, were put under the Clean Ganga Mission. So Lucknow doesn't have Ganga, but then the Ganga, Clean Ganga Mission money, it has a huge budget of some 20,000 crore rupees. And the government is using all that money to build sewage treatment plants, to lay down sewage lines, and the argument from the government's point of view would be that in Lucknow you have Gomti River, so Gomti goes and joins Ganga, so by keeping the sewage from flowing into Gomti, you are indirectly contributing to clean Ganga. But essentially what they did was, what should have been done by the state governments, because every state government has a sanitation department, and it is the responsibility of the state governments, or the not even the state government, the municipal corporations actually, to lay down the sewage lines and to ensure that the sewage doesn't flow into the rivers. This is the responsibility of the municipal corporations. But the central government has usurped this power, and it wanted to do everything centrally. It wanted to award the contracts for building sewage treatment plants and everything, from the center. Only in the second term of Narendra Modi, now some decentralization has taken place, and that is why construction of sewage lines is going on at present on a big scale. But this government is in the habit of centralizing things, and nobody
realizing the dangers associated with it, basically.
And also a well-known fact is that whenever you centralize projects, then there's bigger chances of corruption. So, once we were doing a social audit of NREGS in one block of Unnao district, and we found that every Gram Pradhan was buying the same number of trees at the same rate from the same nursery. That is not possible. I mean, the way it would have happened is the chief development officer of the district would have told all the Gram Pradhans to procure the trees, you know, from this one nursery. And he must have done central purchasing. And then centrally purchasing all the trees, he would have distributed it to the Gram Pradhans. And then every Gram Pradhan has put a bill in their accounts for the same number of trees at the same rate from the same nursery. So this, whenever there is centralization of power, and especially, you know, big projects which involve big money, there is big corruption. So on one hand, the Modi government says, or the BJP government's claim, that corruption has reduced in their regime. But as I have said earlier also, our experience is that the corruption has increased. It has not decreased. And one of the factors in the increase of corruption is this centralization of decision making, centralization of projects. You know, big money for big projects means big corruption. So this is also a motive, you know, behind the centralization of decision making power, and which actually undermines our federal structure, and the BJP government, because of its ideology, you know, it follows an ideology, and it is a characteristic of that ideology that you cannot logically argue things in that framework. I mean, if Ram temple has to be built in Ayodhya, then everybody has to believe that Ram was born at that place. It is a matter of astha. You cannot argue. So similarly, you know, if you have branded somebody anti-national, then you can't argue. You just brand somebody anti-national, and then, you know, the Hindutva brigade goes after such people. So in the case of mob lynchings, you see that they don't even give time to ascertain the facts, and they will start beating people and will kill them and things like that. So the nature of the ideology is such that there is very little scope for discussion and debate, and therefore all the decisions have to be made at the top level, and then everybody has to follow. So because of these two reasons, one, that, you know, bigger centralization and bigger projects means bigger corruption, and secondly, the nature of ideology which governs the Bharatiya Janata Party is such that there is very little scope for discussion and debate. It suits them that they undermine the federal structure and make the decision making centralized, and this is what we have seen happening over the past 6 years since Narendra Modi has come to power.
Right, precisely, sir. And I think to ensure that there is effective privatization, and that is something, you know, so it's a very confusing space. We are here talking about law and order. We are here trying to understand governance. 5 years from now, 4 years from now, when we read about this phase in, you know, the discourse, we'll see that the key stakeholders or institutions that were being affected the most, and the principle which was being affected the most, was federalism. And I don't think so. I have to mention about, you know, the fact that I think it was the budget of 2020, if I'm not wrong, which was historic, because it was the budget that gave, handed over or deregularized a lot of, if you have to correct me on this. I think it was something like that. And what we are right now seeing, and this is something that I noticed in the protest sites as well, in the speeches that were made by the leadership, which is about they are not just worried about the farming sector. They are talking about schools. They are talking about hospitals. They are talking about colleges. They are talking about opportunities that are being stripped away or being taken away because of this pattern of privatization. And it just doesn't stop at farming. Maybe there's more to come. So the inequality wedge that is there between the rich and the poor, and I hate to say this, that haves and have-nots, but unfortunately what these laws maybe are trying to do is that they are trying to widen the already existing gap, which is so, I would say, appalling and sad if you have to study development, you know, inclusive development or governance as such. So I want to ask that why is India one of those countries that spends the lowest when it comes to public health, when it comes to education? I can understand there are national security issues. I can understand there have to be, you know, budgetary allocations that are to be made in various domains. But there are fundamental issues when we talk about public sector institutions, when we talk about colleges, let's say, why aren't there more options for somebody who has, you know, done 12th and wants to pursue other options and is sadly made into this rat race of scoring the best, because that's the cutoff that is laid out. It was fine for a few generations behind me, but with the influx of so much and the population rising, and there are multiple factors, that there is a limitation of resources. And the only available resources are also something that are being handed over by the government to the corporate. So what is the solution to this? Do you see a midway in this? Do you see, obviously, you know, and there are a lot of people, there are a lot of economists who say that they are complete favor of liberal markets, they are in complete favor of free markets, and market determines everything. And I can understand those economists' phenomena or the way they base their arguments. But then there are fundamental, you know, concepts. There are economists who put forth this, like, you know, Nobel laureate Amartya Sen, or even the recently awarded Abhishek Banerjee, if I'm not wrong, his name is Abhishek Banerjee, the one who was awarded from JNU. They mention about the fact that, you know, state institutions cannot just be whittled down. They have to be revived. The fact that today Indian masses are not satisfied with the way public sector institutions work is not the reason that everything has to be privatized. The inefficiency of one system cannot lead to a complete handing over of one economic system, you know, to privatization, especially in a country as poor and having such a high density of population such as ours. So what do you have to say about this? Is there going to be a stop, and is there a way? Like, all we say about the BJP government is that, okay, only electoral defeat can put them on can stop them. But it's very sad to say that we have to stoop down to the fact that only electoral defeat can do that. I mean, the democracy has many other tools as well to make sure that the resources are being allocated equitably. And when you go to the farmers' movement, when you go to the protest site, all the basic demand of the farmer is to distribute the resources equally, to gain access, which is, you know, exactly what the laws is opposite to. So I want to just have your views on, are there any other tools that can ensure that the way we are, the way economic and social system of our country is headed towards, is there a coming back, or the damage which is done is too much that, you know, we can't come back?
Yeah.
So, yeah.
So first, let me take up the question of Ankit. Mm-hmm. Ankit has asked that number of these laws, you know, that BJP is making were actually initiated by the Congress. It is true that, you know, from Rafael deal to GST to, you know, the farm laws and number of other things, you know, were initiated by the Congress government. But Ankit, there is a difference that the BJP government has tweaked things. They are not the same laws. For example, I am told that in the law for contract farming, if the farmer is dissatisfied, he or she can only go to the SDM, the subdivisional magistrate. He or she cannot approach the court. So this clause was not there in the Congress draft. So the BJP government has made it more anti-farmer than, I mean, you are right that this entire, the economic policy that Simran was talking about, the economic policies of privatization, liberalization and globalization, which were implemented in India in 1991, were done by a Congress government, the Narasimha Rao government. And every government after that, whether Congress or BJP or the Janata Dal government, they have essentially promoted these policies. But as Simran was saying, that these policies are increasing the gap between the rich and the poor, and that is not just the experience in India. You go to any third world countries where the governments have implemented the recommendation of the World Bank and International Monetary Fund to privatize, liberalize, and globalize their economy. The gap between the rich and the poor has increased. So, Simran is right in saying that in this farmers' movement, now the debate is not just focused on the farm bills. People are also talking about the education and the healthcare and things like that. In fact, one of my friends made a very good argument one day. He is a young fellow and I learned from him. So he was explaining to the people in Kannauj in a meeting which I also attended. He was saying that the government is saying that we are not going to take away MSP. We are not going to close down the mandis. But what will happen is what happened to the government schools. The government has not closed the government schools. The government schools are still there, right? But the quality of government schools has gone down. I mean, the two generations back, every member of our families was going to government schools. And then slowly, for example, my father went to a government school. I went to a Kendriya Vidyalaya, and then my children are going to. They went to a private school and they are attending private universities. So this has happened over a period of time, that when you allowed the private players to come in, the private schools, then the quality of the government schools went down because everybody who could pay, they moved over to the private schools. Similarly, a similar thing is happening with the hospitals. There was a time when government hospitals were the only option available to people. But as the private hospitals have mushroomed, now I'm surprised to see that even poor people, they somehow land up in private hospitals, and then they will incur, huge debts. They often cannot pay the fee of these hospitals, and then they have to sell their land or their belongings or take loans, at exorbitant interest rates, and then are under debt. So just as the quality of government schools and hospitals has deteriorated, similarly, the government market system and the MSP will suffer, and the private companies will prosper. Now, what is the option before us, as is the question that Simran has put, because apparently we are on this track of privatization, liberalization and globalization, and going ahead, nobody seems to be reversing the trend. I don't know what the answer is, because it is not so easy now for the government to make a comeback. But all I would like to say is that the best systems which seem to be working in the interest of people. So first of all, you have to see from which point of view are you looking at things. Delhi model. Ankit is talking about the Delhi model, and I also wanted to say a similar thing. So it is very important that you first decide which point of view are you looking things from. I mean, if you are looking at things from the point of view of the rich, the private sector, then obviously these policies have benefited the rich class. I mean, in terms of, you know, all the facilities, all the modern facilities that have become available to Indian homes now, the Indian middle class and the upper middle class have benefited. But if you look at things from the point of view of the poor, then I don't think the poor has gained. I mean, poor has definitely, the lifestyle has improved, but the gap has increased between the rich and the poor. And the poor continue to be deprived of the basic rights. So the short answer is that the fundamental rights of people, the right to life, should not be violated. So which means that basic things like roti, kapda, makan, you know, should not be handed over to the private sector, which means we should have the agriculture should remain with the government. The government should determine the policy. They should not hand it over to the private. We should have a strong public distribution system. We should have a strong midday meal program, integrated child development program. So we have to keep all these programs very strong in order to ensure that there is food security in the country. Because Manmohan Singh, as Prime Minister, had told us that half the children in India are malnourished, and you cannot progress, with half your children, half your population undernourished. So the food system has to be very strong. The housing system has to be such that everybody has a decent house to live in. But unfortunately, even as we talk in Lucknow, the authorities are demolishing the slums in the name of, you know, making these our cities smart cities. So the poor has to, the rich people, the middle class, the upper middle class likes the idea of a smart city, but it is at the cost of the poor, because their slums are going to be bulldozed. And was just at a meeting with a railway official before coming to this meeting, where I was requesting her, she is the DRM of Northeastern Railway, to postpone the demolition of a slum which is located on a railway land opposite the Lucknow Medical College, at least while the winter is there. I was trying to argue with her that, you know, you can get your land vacated, but do it after the winter so that people don't have to suffer. And it will be better if you make some alternative housing available to the people. So Simran, I'll have to just take a leave for 5 minutes because somebody is at the door. So can you just have somebody?
No worries, sir.
Yeah.
Yes, sure, sir.
Hello.
So I don't think we have any participants as well. Ankit, I'll also have to take a leave because I am also... Omkarji, your poem.
Ranji, Sashrikalji.
Sashrikal, Sashrikal.
Meri poem tu yaad rakh de ji, thank you.
Ranji.
ਇੱਕ ਮਿੰਟ ਮੈਮ
ਹਾਂ ਕੋਈ ਗੱਲ ਨਹੀਂ ਹਾਂਜੀ
ਮੈਡਮ ਮੈਂ ਥੋੜਾ ਲੇਟ ਅੱਜ ਹੋ ਗਿਆ ਸੀ ਕਿਤੇ ਗਏ ਹੋਏ ਸੀਗੇ ਜੀ ਅੱਜ
ਕੋਈ ਗੱਲ
ਥੋੜਾ ਲੇਟ ਆਈ ਜੀ ਤੇ ਚਲੋ ਜੀ ਹਾਂਜੀ ਹਾਂ ਸੁਣਾਉਣ ਲੱਗਿਆ ਜੀ ਜੇ ਸੱਚ ਬੋਲਿਆ ਬੇੜੀਆਂ ਮਿੱਤਰਾ ਪੈਰਾਂ ਦੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਪਹਿਣਗੀਆਂ ਝੂਠ ਬੋਲੇਗਾ ਅਗਲੀਆਂ ਨਸਲਾਂ ਮਾੜਾ ਤੈਨੂੰ ਕਹਿਣਗੀਆਂ 19 ਵਾਰ ਜਿੱਤ ਲਈ ਦਿੱਲੀ 19 ਵਾਰ ਜਿੱਤ ਲਈ ਦਿੱਲੀ ਤੇ ਹੁਣ ਵਾਰੀ 20ਵੀਂ ਆ ਪਤਾ ਨਹੀਂ ਕਦ ਤੱਕ ਸਰਕਾਰਾਂ ਨਾਲ ਪੰਜਾਬ ਦੇ ਖਹਿਣਗੀਆਂ ਧਰਮ ਦੇ ਨਾਂ ਤੇ ਪਾ ਕੇ ਵੰਡੀਆਂ ਲੋਕ ਮਰਾ ਛੱਡੇ ਹੋਰ ਪਤਾ ਨਹੀਂ ਕੌਮਾਂ ਕਿੰਨੇ ਵਾਰ ਸੀਨੇ ਤੇ ਸਹਿਣਗੀਆਂ ਰੋਜੀ ਰੋਟੀ ਦੇ ਲਈ ਘਰ ਤੋਂ ਗਏ ਕਿੰਨੇ ਹੀ ਗੱਭਰੂ ਮੁੜਨਾ ਆਏ ਮਾਮਾ ਕਦ ਤੱਕ ਰਾਹਾਂ ਦੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਬਹਿਣਗੀਆਂ ਰੱਖ ਹੌਸਲਾ ਦਿਲ ਨਾ ਛੱਡਿਓ ਜਿੱਤ ਯਕੀਨਣ ਹੋਵੇਗੀ ਵਿੱਚ ਪੰਜਾਬ ਦੇ ਜੰਮਿਆਂ ਨੂੰ ਤੇਜੇ ਨਿੱਤ ਮੁਹਿੰਮਾਂ ਰਹਿਣਗੀਆਂ ਨਿੱਤ ਮੁਹਿੰਮਾਂ ਰਹਿਣਗੀਆਂ ਸ਼ੁਕਰੀਆ ਜੀ
ਥੈਂਕ ਯੂ ਓਂਕਾਰ ਜੀ ਵੈਰੀ ਨਾਈਸ
ਸ਼ੁਕਰੀਆ ਜੀ
ਵੈਰੀ ਹਾਰਟ
ਓਕੇ ਜੀ
हेलो
हाँ सो आई एम लीविंग एट द मोमेंट आई हैव अनदर मीटिंग थैंक यू सर गुड इवनिंग
Hello, am I audible? Hello.
Yes, you are.
So anyone wants to say anything? Rahul ji, last comments. Onkar ji. We can close the session for today.
Ankit, main thoda sa apna argument pura kar lu.
हाँ जी, हाँ जी सर प्लीज.
जो मैं आर्ग्यू कर रहा था तो वो सिमरन ने जो सवाल पूछा था कि आखिर रास्ता क्या है, तो ये जो मूवमेंट चल रहा है किसानों का, ये इस हिसाब से बहुत महत्वपूर्ण है कि इससे ये तय होने वाला है कि आगे हमारे देश की दिशा क्या होगी. क्या हम हर एक सेक्टर का प्राइवेटाइजेशन करते चले जाएंगे जैसे हम करते चले आ रहे हैं 1991 से, या फिर हम जनता के हित में कुछ नीतियां बनाएंगे. अरे ओंकार जी जरा अपना माइक ऑफ कर लीजिएगा. ओंकार भाई
जी, जी.
हाँ तो ये इसलिए भी ये मूवमेंट बहुत महत्वपूर्ण है क्योंकि ये तय करने वाला है कि आगे की दिशा क्या होगी. और हमारी सरकारें धीरे धीरे करके हर एक क्षेत्र को प्राइवेटाइजेशन करती जा रही हैं, और हमारे देश में आप देखिए अब जो प्राइवेट कंपनियां हैं वो बड़े पैमाने पर हर एक चीज में अब दखल अंदाजी करने लगी हैं, चाहे वो हमारा फूड सिस्टम हो, हाउसिंग सिस्टम हो, हमारा जो है ट्रांसपोर्टेशन हो. इंडियन रेलवेज के प्राइवेटाइजेशन की बात हो रही है, एयर इंडिया को बेचने की बात तो पहले से ही चल रही थी, कांग्रेस के समय से ही चल रही थी. और इस तरह से आप देखिए कि हर एक क्षेत्र में प्राइवेट कंपनियां घुसती चली आ रही हैं, और इसका खामियाजा आम इंसान को भुगतना पड़ता है. क्योंकि जैसे अगर आप रेलवे को ले लें तो रेलवे में जब प्राइवेटाइजेशन हो जाएगा तो जो प्राइवेट ट्रेन्स चल रही हैं वो सब एसी क्लास वाली ट्रेन्स हैं. उसमें जो स्लीपर क्लास हैं या जनरल क्लास हैं इस तरह के डिब्बे शायद नहीं होंगे, या होंगे तो कम होंगे. और आपको मालूम है कि बड़ी संख्या में भारत में जो चलने वाले लोग हैं वो स्लीपर क्लास और जनरल क्लास में चलते हैं, एसी में चलने वाले लोग कम होते हैं. तो इससे गरीब इंसान का जो है नुकसान होगा. उसके लिए जो ऑप्शन है रेलवे में चलने का वो बंद हो जाएगा, और बस का किराया रेलवे से ज्यादा होता है, कम से कम 3 गुना होता है, 3 गुना नहीं तो 2 गुना तो होता ही है. तो गरीब इंसान के लिए यात्रा करना वो एक एक महंगी चीज हो जाएगी, और फिर वो आसानी से एक जगह से दूसरी जगह नहीं जा पाएगा. तो हमारे जो पब्लिक सिस्टम्स हैं, जो हमारे बेसिक एरियाज हैं, जो बेसिक ह्यूमन नीड्स हैं, फूड, क्लोथ्स, शेल्टर और ट्रांसपोर्टेशन और कम्युनिकेशन, ये पांच एरियाज मैं मानता हूं कि ये इसमें पब्लिक सिस्टम्स होने चाहिए, पब्लिक ट्रांसपोर्ट सिस्टम होना चाहिए, पब्लिक कम्युनिकेशन सिस्टम होना चाहिए। ये चीज़ें हमको प्राइवेट सेक्टर को नहीं देनी चाहिए, क्योंकि यह प्राइवेट सेक्टर को दे भी तो आपका एक स्ट्रॉन्ग गवर्नमेंट सिस्टम भी होना चाहिए, ताकि आम इंसान को असुविधा ना हो। और इसके अलावा एजुकेशन और हेल्थ केयर दो ऐसे सेक्टर हैं जिनको आपको प्राइवेट सेक्टर को नहीं सौंपना चाहिए। और जहाँ जहाँ पे अच्छे स्कूल सिस्टम्स और हेल्थ केयर सिस्टम्स काम कर रहे हैं, वो गवर्नमेंट के हाथों में है। और अंकित ने खुद ही कहा है कि दिल्ली का आप एजुकेशन का मॉडल देखिए, जो काफी बेहतर हो गया है, और इस वजह से हुआ है क्योंकि वहां की गवर्नमेंट ने उसमें उसमें रुचि ली है, उसमें उसने रुचि लेके उसकी क्वालिटी को इम्प्रूव किया है। और इसी तरह से बॉबी बताएंगे कि दुनिया के करीब 30-35 देश ऐसे हैं जहाँ हेल्थ केयर सिस्टम जो है वो गवर्नमेंट के हाथों में है और वो फ्री है लोगों के लिए। अमेरिका के अंदर हाई स्कूल तक की एजुकेशन, जो उनका हाई स्कूल है वो अपना इंटरमीडिएट होता है या क्लास 12 होता है, वो एजुकेशन फ्री होती है। ऑप्शन है प्राइवेट का, लेकिन कम लोग प्राइवेट में भेजते हैं, जो बहुत अमीर लोग होते हैं वही प्राइवेट में भेजते हैं। ज़्यादातर लोग अपने नेबरहुड में जो स्कूल होता है वहाँ पे अपने बच्चों को भेजते हैं, और फीस नहीं पड़ती है, बल्कि आपकी किताबें, यूनिफॉर्म और जो ट्रांसपोर्टेशन है वो भी फ्री होता है, वो लोकल गवर्नमेंट की तरफ से व्यवस्था होती है। तो एजुकेशन और हेल्थ केयर सिस्टम्स भी अच्छे वहीं पे काम कर रहे हैं जहां वो गवर्नमेंट उनको चला रही है, यानी वो कॉमन स्कूल सिस्टम है और वो इस तरह के हेल्थ केयर सिस्टम है जो सबके लिए उपलब्ध है और ये फ्री है। तो जो जो मॉडल पूरी दुनिया में जो काम कर रहे हैं, जिससे कि आम इंसान को फायदा पहुंच रहा है, वो मॉडल तो सोशलिस्ट मॉडल है, वो कैपिटलिस्ट मॉडल नहीं है। इसलिए अगर हम प्राइवेटाइजेशन की दिशा में बढ़ेंगे तो हम इस बात को भूल जाएं कि हम सबके लिए काम करना चाहते हैं, फिर वो हम जो समाज का जो अमीर वर्ग है, जो पैसे वाला वर्ग है, हम एक तरीके से उसी के लिए नीतियां बना रहे हैं और हम प्राइवेट कंपनियों के मुनाफे के लिए नीतियां बना रहे हैं। तो जब एजुकेशन और हेल्थ केयर जैसी चीजों में मुनाफा कमाने के बारे में लोग सोचने लगेंगे तो जाहिर है कि गुणवत्ता गिरेगी, और जो हम अपने चारों तरफ देख रहे हैं कि कितने सब स्टैंडर्ड स्कूल्स और हॉस्पिटल्स आ गए हैं जो क्वालिटी के साथ कॉम्प्रोमाइज करते हैं, लोगों को लूटते हैं, क्वालिटी की सर्विसेज नहीं देते हैं, और अगर आप इनसे परेशान हो तो आप कुछ इनके खिलाफ कर भी नहीं सकते, क्योंकि ये इनके पास पैसे की ताकत होती है, ये अधिकारियों को इन्फ्लुएंस कर लेते हैं, पॉलिटिशियंस को इन्फ्लुएंस कर लेते हैं, और कई बार कोर्ट्स को भी इन्फ्लुएंस कर लेते हैं। हम लोग जो लखनऊ के अंदर सिटी मॉन्टेसरी के खिलाफ लड़ाई लड़ रहे हैं, जो राइट टू एजुकेशन एक्ट में 25% गरीब बच्चों का एडमिशन फ्री होना चाहिए, ये स्कूल नहीं लेता है, और इसके खिलाफ आप कोई भी कोर्ट में भी अगर जाए तो कोर्ट से भी आपको फेवरेबल जजमेंट नहीं मिलता है। तो ये प्राइवेट प्लेयर्स इतने पावरफुल हो जाते हैं कि ये जनता के जो बेसिक राइट्स हैं उसके लिए अगर जनता लड़ना चाहे तो वो लड़ाई मुश्किल हो जाती है। इसलिए भी हमारे जो बेसिक जो नीड्स वाले क्षेत्र हैं, फूडिंग, क्लोथिंग, हाउसिंग, एजुकेशन, हेल्थ केयर, ट्रांसपोर्टेशन, कम्युनिकेशन, ये जो फील्ड्स हैं, इनको कम से कम हमको प्राइवेट हाथों में नहीं सौंपना चाहिए, इतना मुझे समझ में आता है। लेकिन ये एकदम आइडियल सोल्यूशन है ऐसा मैं नहीं कह रहा हूँ, लेकिन जो दुनिया का अनुभव है उसके आधार पे हम इतना कह सकते हैं कि ये जो पब्लिक सिस्टम्स हैं ये आम लोगों के दृष्टि से बेहतर परफॉर्म करते हैं, बेहतर सेवाएं देते हैं, और अगर आप इनको प्राइवेटाइज करेंगे तो हो सकता है कि उसकी क्वालिटी बढ़िया हो जाए, लेकिन वो उसका लाभ फिर सिर्फ कुछ लोगों को ही मिलेगा, वो लाभ सबको नहीं मिलेगा। ओंकार सिंह जी बताइए।
सर ऐसा है कि अगर जो स्कूल है और हेल्थ सिस्टम है हमारा,
जी,
वहाँ पे एक स्कूल की एग्जांपल देता हूँ सर। जैसे हमारे जो मंत्री है, कोई भी जो गवर्नमेंट के खजाने से पैसा ले रहा है, कोई गवर्नमेंट जॉब पे है या कोई मंत्री है, कुछ भी है, वो अगर उन सभी का बच्चा उस सरकारी स्कूल में पढ़ेगा तो उसकी कंडीशन है जो अच्छी हो जाएगी, और वो भी उस पर ध्यान देंगे पूरा। प्राइवेटाइजेशन बंद हो सकती है, मगर ये सर चाहते नहीं। इनके जो हमारे लीडर है वो तो इलाज करवाना होता है, बाहर जाते हैं, प्राइवेट में करवाते हैं, आप तो सरकारी में जाते नहीं सर। उसका सुधार तो बिल्कुल नहीं हो सकेगा अगर अगर ये ऐसा हो। वैसे हमें ये, हम, मैं स्कूल में जॉब करता हूँ, हमारे पास कई बार लेटर आते रहते हैं कि अपने बच्चों को सरकारी स्कूल में एडमिशन दो, तो हमारी यूनियन इसका भी रोल आप डालती रहती है कि जो सभी मंत्री है वो भी सरकारी स्कूल में अपने बच्चे को डालो, हम भी डालेंगे। आप पर ये रूल क्यों नहीं लागू होता, हमारे पर ही क्यों थोप रहे हो?
सही
और
ये
सर ऐसा है ना, ईमानदारी नहीं है सर बस। और जो ऐसा हो जाए हमारे देश में तो चलो, फिर तो लगता है हेल्थ सिस्टम भी सेट हो जाएगा सर, तो एजुकेशन वाला भी सेट हो जाएगा। जी
जी जी
जी हाँ जी, थैंक।
आपकी बात बिल्कुल सही है ओंकार भाई। और आपको बता दें कि उत्तर प्रदेश में तो हाई कोर्ट का एक जजमेंट है 2015 का, जज का नाम है सुधीर अग्रवाल, जिन्होंने कहा कि अगर सरकारी स्कूलों की गुणवत्ता को ठीक करना है तो उसका अब सिर्फ एक ही रास्ता रह गया है, और वो ये है कि जितने लोगों को सरकारी तनख्वाह मिल रही है, चाहे वो मंत्री हो, अधिकारी हो, जज हो, उन सबके बच्चे सरकारी स्कूल में जाने चाहिए। ये हाईकोर्ट का जजमेंट है उत्तर प्रदेश में, जिसे ना तो अखिलेश यादव गवर्नमेंट ने इम्प्लीमेंट किया और न ही योगी आदित्यनाथ की गवर्नमेंट इम्प्लीमेंट करने को तैयार है। मेरी दोनों मुख्यमंत्रियों से पर्सनल बातचीत हुई है। उस समय तो मैं अनशन पे बैठा था जब अखिलेश यादव से बातचीत हुई थी, और योगी आदित्यनाथ से भी दो बार मेरी बात हुई है। दो ही बार मैं मिला हूँ आज तक अपने जीवन में उनसे, और वो दोनों बार सिर्फ हमारी इसी मुद्दे पे बात हुई कि सुधीर अग्रवाल के जजमेंट को कैसे लागू कराया जाए। और वो हमें तमाम तर्क देते रहे। पहली बार 45 मिनट उन्होंने बात की, दूसरी बार उन्होंने 10-15 मिनट बात की, और दोनों बार में वो मुझे बताते रहे कि वो कितना अच्छा काम कर रहे हैं एजुकेशन में, लेकिन उन्होंने सुधीर अग्रवाल के जजमेंट को इम्प्लीमेंट करने के बारे में कुछ नहीं कहा। तो आखिर में मुझे उनसे पूछना पड़ा कि भाई मैं जिस काम के लिए आया था उसके बारे में तो आपने कुछ कहा नहीं। तो उन्होंने मुझे सिर्फ इतना कहा कि नहीं नहीं आप प्रयास करते रहिए, लेकिन उन्होंने कुछ कोई कोई जहमत नहीं उठाई कि उसके बारे में वो कुछ करें। तो आपकी बात सही है, ईमानदारी नहीं है। ये जो हमारा रूलिंग एलीट है, ये नहीं चाहता है कि प्राइवेट स्कूल्स या प्राइवेट अस्पताल खत्म हो, क्योंकि वो खुद इनकी इनका लाभ उठाना चाहते हैं। उनको लगता है कि ये उनके लिए सुविधाजनक है, और ये भी बात है कि उनके कुछ वेस्टेड इंटरेस्ट भी हैं। जैसे अभी क्या हुआ कि जो एमएलसी का इलेक्शन हुआ, मेंबर फॉर लेजिस्लेटिव काउंसिल का, उसमें इन्होंने प्राइवेट स्कूल के टीचरों को भी वोटर बना लिया जो पहले नहीं थे, और इनके कैंडिडेट जीत गए भारतीय जनता पार्टी के। तो कई बार ये जो पॉलिटिकल पार्टीज हैं ये अपनी मीटिंग कराती हैं तो जो वैसे हॉल हैं, पब्लिक हॉल्स हैं, वो उतने अच्छे नहीं होंगे, लेकिन ये जो प्राइवेट स्कूल्स और कॉलेजेस हैं इन्होंने बढ़िया बढ़िया हॉल बना लिए हैं, सारी मॉडर्न फैसिलिटीज के साथ। तो जगदीश गांधी जी जो सिटी मॉन्टेसरी स्कूल के मालिक हैं, वो पॉलिटिकल पार्टीज को ओबलाइज करते रहते हैं, और इसलिए वो जो भी गैर कानूनी काम करें, जमीन पे कब्जा करें, लोगों से पैसा उधार लें और हड़प जाएं, बिना प्रॉपर परमिशन के कंस्ट्रक्शन करा लें, लेकिन उनके खिलाफ कोई एक्शन नहीं होता है। गरीब बच्चों के एडमिशन नहीं लेते हैं राइट टू एजुकेशन एक्ट के तहत, लेकिन उनके खिलाफ कोई एक्शन नहीं होता, क्योंकि उनके स्कूलों में बड़े बड़े आईएएस अधिकारी, नेता, जजों के बच्चे पढ़ते हैं, और उनके खिलाफ अगर कोई एक्शन लेना चाहेगा तो उनके पक्ष में बहुत सारे प्रभावशाली लोग खड़े हो जाते हैं।
जी सर, बिल्कुल जी सर। मैंने प्राइवेट जॉब की है कॉलेज में, इंजीनियरिंग कॉलेज में, रोपड़ रायतवाड़ा कॉलेज है जी।
अच्छा,
वहाँ पे जॉब की
जी।
तो सर देखा कि वहाँ पे आज से 15 साल पहले की बात है, और 80,000 रुपया एक बच्चे की सर एक साल की फीस थी इंजीनियरिंग कॉलेज की, अगर सरकार चाहे अगर गवर्नमेंट कॉलेज की 80 की जगह पे 40 भी हो, 40,000 तो सर बच्चे को बचेगा और 40 गवर्नमेंट को मिलेगा, बड़ा पैसा कमा सकती थी गवर्नमेंट उस टाइम में। बीएड के कॉलेज थे, इंजीनियरिंग कॉलेज थे, बड़ा पैसा उन्होंने कमाया सर, 1 करोड़ रुपया देते थे वो, मैं वहां पे कॉलेज में था तभी, 1 करोड़ में उन्होंने डीम्ड यूनिवर्सिटी का सर उन्होंने ले लिया, इन्होंने कानून पास किया, 1 करोड़ रुपया लेते थे पूरा कैंपस से पूरे से, उसको डीम्ड यूनिवर्सिटी बना देते थे। और सर देखो कोई भी मंत्री है वो इलाज करवाने के लिए बाहर जाता है, अमेरिका में जाता है, कहीं और जाता है। देखो 70 साल में इन्होंने एक इनको पूरे इंडिया में ऐसा हॉस्पिटल नहीं लगा कि जो इसका इनका इलाज कर सके, और कोई ऐसा इनको स्कूल नहीं लगा पूरे इंडिया में जो इनके बच्चों को पढ़ा सके। जब ये सर अपने के लिए नहीं सोच सकते कि इंडिया में इनके लेवल का नहीं है, तो बाकी लोगों का क्या करेंगे जी? देखो अपना तो रब ही रखा है अभी।
हेलो ओंकार जी, आपकी बात कंप्लीट हो गई?
हाँ जी, हाँ जी, जी सर,
हाँ जी, हाँ जी। सो ऑल्सो आई थिंक हम टाइम से भी ऊपर चले गए हैं, सो मैं अपने क्लोजिंग रिमार्क्स दे देता हूँ आज का। बेसिकली जो हमारा सत्याग्रह प्लेटफॉर्म है, सो बेसिकली ये स्टार्ट किया गया था टू टॉक अबाउट द इश्यूज, उनको आइडेंटिफाई करने के लिए, एंड टू इन्वाइट एक्सपर्ट्स ओवर द प्लेटफॉर्म, एंड अगर पॉसिबल सोल्यूशन हम कुछ अपनी तरफ से कर सकते हैं तो उसको डिस्कस करने के लिए। बट ग्रेजुअली वी आर रियलाइजिंग कि हम कोई भी इशू डिस्कस करते हैं तो हम एक इशू से भी काफी सारे इशूज निकल के सामने आते हैं। जैसे अभी हम फार्मर्स प्रोटेस्ट की बात कर रहे हैं जिसके लिए हम डेली सेशन ऑर्गेनाइज कर रहे हैं, सो हमें पता लगता है कि उसका कहीं ना कहीं जो लिंक है वो प्राइवेटाइजेशन, ग्लोबलाइजेशन एंड गवर्नमेंट का एक पर्टिकुलर जो उनका स्टांस है प्राइवेटाइजेशन की तरफ, एक प्रॉफिट मेकिंग की तरफ, कहीं ना कहीं उसकी तरफ जा रहा है। वो लोगों की वेलफेयर के हितों में नहीं, मतलब कॉर्पोरेट के हितों में जा रहे हैं। सो इट इज ऑलवेज गुड टू हैव संदीप सर विद अस टू हु हमें मतलब इतना इंफॉर्मेशन प्रोवाइड करते हैं देश के बारे में। एक इंट्रोस्पेक्शन काइंड ऑफ सेशन बन जाता है ये कि हम कहां, हमने कहां से स्टार्ट किया था और हम कहां पे जा रहे हैं जस्ट बिकॉज ऑफ फ्यू करप्ट पॉलिटिशियंस और करप्ट पॉलिसीज। सो आई थिंक टुडे ऑल्सो भी हमने फेडरलिज्म की बात करी, लिबरलाइजेशन की बात करी, प्राइवेटाइजेशन की बात करी, एंड एंड में वी केम टू नो कि जो हमारे स्कूल्स हैं एंड हॉस्पिटल्स हैं वो भी कहीं ना कहीं प्राइवेटाइजेशन के उसमें एक टोनेडो में कहीं ना कहीं आ गए हैं। सो एंड ऑन दिस नोट आई थिंक वी कैन कंक्लूड टुडे सेशन। सो होप टू सी यू ऑल टुमारो। थैंक यू।